And our foundation, we are very, very clear that because our funding is very limited, we are not a very, very big foundation like the APPI or the Tata Trust. We have a very limited budget, and we wanted to really ensure that our return on investment is very high. So, you know, you'll hear that about it very, very often in all the forums. And so we started to identify which are the gap areas in the ecosystem with, you know, with minimum investment, we can get maximum returns. And when I'm talking about returns, I'm talking about social returns. And when we started to do this gap analysis, we worked with, you know, our partners, Britspan, who helped us to do like a strategy exercise to understand how can we be more strategic. And definitely capacity building was more opportunistic, you know, a few years back. But then we said, let's understand what investment in capacity building can we do and how can we be more strategic. And what we really have now moved to saying that although our cohort of NGOs is very small, we are going to work towards building a lot of evidence around capacity building, because that is very critical for the sector to understand what it really takes, you know, for the NGOs to be more sustainable and financially resilient. So our approach is really to work with a small set of NGOs and work on building evidences and then change the narrative in the ecosystem to be able to driving more capital towards organization building, which is more data driven rather than, you know, intuition driven. So, you know, that has been really the change that we have seen in the last couple of years in the foundation.
Last couple of years, we have focused on capacity building, but in small ways and in different ways, we have been doing it for a long time. Maybe it was not a very well planned approach. While you're not, one works with different sized organization or in various thematic areas, it becomes actually imperative to kind of notice the internal capacity and help out the NGOs. So we used to host these annual workshops through CAP for many years, where, you know, sessions like finance for non-financers or robust proposal writing or such needs which emerge from our partner NGOs were addressed in these annual workshops. So in some way, we were doing capacity building, although not in a very focused way. And when the foundation was started, you know, besides supporting the core programs of organizations, we also started supporting some capacity building initiatives that came our way. Like, for example, the revisioning exercise of Tara Mobile Creche, which they went through a very large exercise over 2 years of revisioning what Tara Mobile Creche should be doing, was supported through the foundation. Or we are, you know, we are very keen that research in this area in the social sector should become strong and should inform the programs. So the monitoring, evaluation and the research vertical in LFE has been supported by the foundation. Or, you know, there were fellowships given for people to attend the DASRA Accelerator program. Then there were website, you know, revamping of the website with a very focused kind of objective to advertise the helpline of connecting NGO and different modalities of fundraising, etc. So what I'm saying is we were doing this in a way which it was capacity building, but they were very small and not so focused programs.
Okay. Just to talk about the outcome readiness work, it's a capacity building program we run for nonprofits to help build their systems and processes to be able to participate or to be able to contract more on outcomes, to be able to deliver on outcomes, to improve the way they are, you know, even thinking and doing and acting and delivering on outcomes. So that's really the core of what the program does, and I'll come to that in a minute. But Prasad, to answer your question and a little bit about BAT, we've been a traditional grant-making organization for over 10 years. We were set up by South Asian businessmen in the UK, and we're supported by the diaspora. And we started out as a traditional grant-maker working with NGOs. And over a period of time, I think our main learning through all of this, through working with donors on one side and nonprofits on the other side, was, you know, what is the value we are creating for these nonprofits? Are they really incentivized to deliver on outcomes? We keep giving them grants which are linked to activities, to inputs, but we keep asking them to report on outcomes. We keep asking them to report on impact. And does the structure really enable them to do that, right? And I think our friend Ratish from Sattva recently wrote a really brilliant piece on this on LinkedIn as well. And from our own learnings, I mean, just taking a step back, as we do these programs and as we watch the, you know, nonprofits go through this journey, think about any situation that any of you have been in. You know, you're running a program, you see great results on one set of activities, and you see somewhat medium results on another set of activities. But do the nonprofits, just in the way the grant is structured, have the ability to chop and change, to take away the funds from what's not working and to put funds into what is, right? Oftentimes you're tied down just by the way the contract is, just by the way the grant is structured, and you're unable to do that, you know, for that little extra that is needed to really push hard on the outcomes. And I think that, you know, was one of our big hypotheses as we were doing all of this work. On the other hand, the other thing we see as ourselves as donors and as we fundraise is there's so much pressure more and more to spend better, to spend smarter. I think philanthropic funding itself is seeing a huge structural change. It seems over the last 5 years, COVID has given it that final push even more in terms of everybody wanting more bang for the buck. So in that context, now more and more donors will ask nonprofits to report on outcomes, will ask them to deliver on outcomes, but they will continue to give the funding tied to particular activity lines. So really just taking a step back, for us the question was, you know, as we worked with our partners through this, was okay, how do we bring this outcome focused thinking? Along this journey, we met a lot of like-minded funders, NSDF, the Dell Foundation, the UBS Optimus. You know, we set up the largest education impact bond in India. And we worked with four nonprofits on that and one for-profit provider. And that also taught us on, you know, what is the outcome-based thinking that is needed? What are the systems and structures and processes that are needed? How do nonprofits, you know, are able to turn around, pivot, chop and change to be able to deliver on outcomes? And that really became the crux of our work. That really became the crux of our thinking.
You know, they say, when the student is ready, the teacher appears, you know? So I was, by the time I was thinking about it a lot of time, and then what to do now, and then Atma appeared. But just before Atma appeared, I was thinking money was the most important thing to start and grow an organization. All that I was looking for was money. And I met Atma people, and then they said, we are not promising you any money. So I was a bit disappointed in the beginning. And then they told me about you know, capacity building and what we can offer. I was very happy. I don't know, something told me that let me go. And I must acknowledge and thank Atma Group, because I was a single person when I reached. I didn't have a team. And I didn't have, though I'm from an organization, I am talking about something new, another organization. So I know, after having graduated for last 3 years, I know Atma, you know, do a lot of screening process. I think Gauri would agree with me. I keep asking some people, like, how did you select me, you know? So that was the thing. So they had the conference. I shared the idea of starting an early intervention center. I just wanted to put a few things before you to understand why capacity building is so important to me. Because now, if someone asked me, do you want money or do you want people, I would ask for people with skills. I would go in that direction rather getting money. My first choice would be, what am I getting? If I'm getting people, I would be rather more happy. So as I told you, I started with one person, that's me, in the year one. And after 3 years of completion, now fourth year, few months over. Now in 2 months time, we'll be seven of us in the team. So that is a significant improvement. Then we started with ₹0. My organization told me, like, okay, you want to do something, you do, but you find your money, you know? So, and I said, okay. And Atma says the other side, we will not be funding you, and you'll have to do your homework and then get your money. I mean, that was a bit discouraging at the time, but when I look back, like now I can go and do anything. Like I'm very confident at the moment. We started with 0 rupees, and after, you know, 3.5 years, I proudly say I have raised both for school and center more than 2 crores of rupees for the organization. You know, so, and now I built a team who are professionally qualified, you know, skillful, and you know, Atma has been supporting me, you know, with you know, all sorts of induction program and capacity building, so many workshops, so many seminars, and including me. So I just want to say one thing, that we knew what to do, but we did not know how to do. So I think Atma did that job for me.